Well, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. This Minister Paul in Northern California. Could I get a volume test of introducing special guest Gary Bear 049. His link is in the description box. We're going to be discussing the third temple and who the Antichrist could possibly be. And we'd like to start off with prayer. Before we start praying, we check the audio, is make sure audio is good. Settings are all good. Let me check my settings. Oh, and I'll put my headphones on. Make sure there's no feedback or anything. That'll help. Volume's awesome, they say. Praise the Lord. So I'd like to start off with prayer. Gary, do you want to begin to pray?
What we think the scriptures are leading us to, Almighty God. So we want to thank you for all.
Brother Gary, they're saying your volume is low. Can't hear you. I'm reading the chat. No, it's really low. Yesterday it wasn't low. There it is.
Is that better?
See, yeah. Isn't it? That's a lot better.
Okay.
Isn't it always like, we talked for how long yesterday? And now we're, a slider had moved. A slider had been moved that in an area I don't even touch, and the Lord just led me right to it.
Yeah.
That's a lot better.
Okay. So, dear Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you for the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and was, at this time, he was buried in the ground in this crypt that they had. And tomorrow we'll be celebrating his resurrection. God, help us bring this close to our heart, God. We ask that you'd bless all of those that are listening, that you'd send the Holy Spirit out to them, that you would undertake for our needs, God. There are so many needs, and we want hope in our lives. That's what this whole thing is about that Minister Paul and I are trying to do. We want to bring people hope that they can trust in the scriptures. The scriptures are absolutely true, and they prophesy about the end times and what's going to be happening soon and what is happening now that lead us to believe that you are coming. So thank you, Lord God, for your holy word, that it was preserved for us all these years, God. So many have tried to wipe out your words and about and your the way your son spoke and what he gave to the people that became his disciples, who later became the heads of these churches that went out throughout the whole world. So, God, we ask that you would undertake for us, that you'd lay your hands upon us in a mighty way.
Yes.
In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we ask the Holy Spirit be here. That same Holy Spirit that resurrected your Son, Father, that lives in us. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray and ask it. Amen.
Amen. Yes, Lord Jesus. We invite your presence in, Lord. We celebrate you. We extol you. We praise you. We worship you. Lord, let your people hear what you want them to hear. Lord, lead us and guide us and direct us in this important message in these last days. So many people need hope. And your word brings hope. And your strength brings hope. And your presence brings hope. And your Son, Jesus Christ, brings hope, Lord. Let him be glorified in all we do today and all we say as we search out the scriptures, studying to show ourselves approved. Lord, make our tongue like the pen of a ready writer to be able to say what you would place on our heart. Lord, we bind all evil spirits that would come against our minds and the technology through the power of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We say, the Lord rebuke you. We are here to bring hope. We are here with a message of hope. And we have to discuss these things because they're so quickly approaching. We're called as watchmen to warn. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. So what we're here to do, we're going to try to discuss a few things. And we're going to talk about the signs that are in the world that point us towards understanding what these scriptures are about. The Bible prophesies when Jesus would come. That's in the beginning, those wise men had read scriptures, and those scriptures pointed to the time of the Messiah. And so they were looking for him because of what they read in those scriptures. And so we know that as Christians, we can use these same scriptures to look for the return of the Lord, because when he left the disciples, he told the angels told them that he's going to come back the same way. And there are clues given throughout the scripture about when the Lord would return. You know, Jesus talked about it in Matthew 24. He talked about how the temple would be destroyed. And he spoke that to the disciples. You know, they were talking about how beautiful the buildings were and all this. And he said, hey, that's all going to be destroyed. And so he also told them that they would be scattered into every nation. And then that they would be gathered back together again. And he talked in reference to a fig tree and about the leaves. And these are signs that tell us, hey, something is going on prophetically in the world. So that's why we want to talk about the coming third temple and the Antichrist. There are some clues that are going on right now in the world that really point to all of that.
We want to be like those three wise men who are looking for the Lord Jesus. That's what we want to be like. We want to be looking and looking at the signs and making decisions and even traveling if we have to. The good thing is he's coming to us. He's coming to us and meeting us in the sky. We got a one-way ticket. Amen.
Amen.
So like you said, we're going to be talking about the third temple here. I'll let Brother Gary have the microphone. He's an expert in these things.
There's a company in Israel, a religious group of people called the Temple Institute, and they have for the past 20 some odd years been working on the temple. You know, hardline Jews really believe that there should be a third temple. And we know that the scriptures tell us that at some point there will be a temple, and that Jesus will enter in the east gate. And when we look at the temple right now, the Temple Mount, we see the walls of the Temple Mount and the base. It's all still standing. This is just the platform on which those buildings stood. The first Temple of Solomon was built and constructed, and this is the one which Jesus, when we look at the Old Testament, they talk about that temple being destroyed during the Babylonian time, and then Herod built the second temple. And when Jesus came into that second temple that was constructed, that is the place where he overthrew the money changers' tables and made a whip out of cords and cast them out of the area just in front of the temple.
And he got angry.
Yes, he did. He was very angry. He whipped them. Imagine that, the Lord. You know, that's a hard thing to visualize, that he would become that angry that he would purposely make a whip out of cords and drive those men out of there. And in the book of Ezekiel, the 43rd chapter, the scripture says, the glory of the Lord entered the temple through the gate facing east. And it's really funny, Minister Paul and I were talking yesterday. He chose the Golden Gate, and that gate on the east is also called the Golden Gate. And it's also where the mercy seat, Jesus is going to come in and go there to the mercy seat. The mercy seat dwelt in that area, off of that gate, of that particular area. This is very significant that the temple is there, because the scripture tells us that he's going to return, his feet are going to touch the Mount of Olives. He's going to, at some point, go back into this temple. So, the Temple Mount, currently they built all of the things, the Temple Mount Institute have built all the things that are necessary for continuing this third temple. In fact, they have the third temple built in like sections, and they say they can assemble it in about 90 days. And over the past few years, about the past 11 years, they've been inching forward with sacrifice, and they have taken a lamb, and then they, on Passover, they would sacrifice it across from the Temple Mount. There's an area, there's a little valley across the Kidron, and they sacrificed this lamb there. And then they built an altar with the four horns that are on the altar. And now they've dedicated that altar, and they brought it up against the side of the Temple Mount and sacrificed a lamb there and then burned the lamb on the altar.
So the Temple Mount is really important for believers and non-believers as we approach what I call the rapture. We also approach tribulation, and that the Temple Mount is really a key in tribulation, isn't it?
Yes. In fact, the Islamic religion and Muslim practicers, they have walled up that eastern gate. The first time they walled it up was in the year 810. And then the Crusaders came and tore all that down, and then Suleiman came and conquered them and made them all leave, and then he walled it up again. So they planted a graveyard in front of that eastern gate, because they believe that Jesus can't walk across graves. And, you know, they don't really recognize him as the creator that he is, that he created everything that we see with our eyes, and that he can create anything. Those graves would just vanish. You know, those, any fortifications you put in front of those gates would just vanish. I don't know, like, if this temple that's going to be made, we know there's a third temple made, because the Bible tells us that the Antichrist stops the daily sacrifice and goes into the temple and declares himself as God at one point during the tribulation period. But, you know, a lot of things happen, so I don't know if that is the actual temple that Christ will return through, or that gate, because we know that the original gate is below ground a little bit, even. So, you know, there's kind of some controversy about that, where this will be located, and, you know, if it's the Ezekiel temple that You know, as you know, Ezekiel prophesied that there would be a temple, and he measured it. So maybe it could be that temple that Christ comes into, and maybe it's a heavenly temple that comes down, or maybe it is this earthly one that these men make. I don't know exactly. I know that the one that they built is this modular thing that they can put together. They also have 1,000+ Kohanim, and those are the people that are trained to be priests, and they're going to do like water libations and various tasks within the temple. They aren't the high priest or anything, but they do have a man they believe could be the high priest, and he could even be the Messiah. And there's been some speculation on the internet about this man and who he is, and some miracles that he's done. He's healed one child that had some really bad disease, and he made some predictions that came true. They say he's performed 5 miracles. So a lot of Jews believe this guy could possibly be the Messiah. So the Temple Mount is steadily moving towards this. In fact, there was talk earlier this year that they were going to build a light rail system that would go up to the Temple Mount. And people were asking, well, why do you need a light rail system for the Temple Mount area? You know, isn't that little bridge just fine that they're using and all these things? Because the WAFC is controlling the Temple Mount, and they aren't Jews. And they're the ones that basically say what you can do there. You know, if you're Jewish or even a Christian, you cannot pray on the Temple Mount. So if they see somebody bowing their head or something, they immediately think they're in prayer, try to stop that from happening. But Muslims can go up there and pray, or people that believe in Islam, whatever sect, they can go up and pray. But it's just Christians or Jews cannot pray on the Temple Mount.
See, a lot of people may not know that. They may just assume that Jews can still go up to the Temple Mount and worship, but they can't.
No,
there's, not at all. You mentioned the subway that they're building that could lead to it, supposedly. There's also 1,000 priests trained.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
1,000 priests trained in the red heifers. Remember the red heifers?
Right. And most people are under the understanding that there were 5 red heifers provided by America to the Jews, and they shipped them there. They received them. They're intact. They're now at some undisclosed location. They're talking about letting people see them. They were concerned about terrorism, somebody trying to kill these heifers, because they've tried for 20 years in Israel to raise a red heifer, and they always have a defect. The scripture says that they can't have ever been used in any work situation to pull a plow or anything, and they have to be pure. In other words, they can't even have one white hair on them and all the red hair. So these 5 are currently meeting this. They don't meet the age requirement, but they're saying possibly that one of them may meet that age requirement this year or early in 2024. And what they do is they have to kill this animal, and then they burn it on an altar or out in the open with they use oak. And they've already done this. They've already taken a cow or a heifer that had died, and they burned it so they could determine how much oak they needed to burn, and then how much ashes they would get out of that. And they've found that they can have enough ashes to anoint every single Jewish person in Israel. So it's quite a bit, and that's what they would like to do.
Is so, this that holy anointing oil they found that's like 2,000 years old?
Yes, there is a holy anointing oil that they needed, because when they built Aaron's robe, right, he has an ephod, which is like an apron, and on that apron there are the 12 stones that are detailed in the Old Testament and the Levitical law, and they talk about, you know, there's diamonds, there's beryl stone, there's opal, there are all these different stones, and they're precious. And then when Aaron would go into the temple, he would ask God questions, and various stones would light up, telling him what tribes to do whatever. And it's just an amazing thing. And they built this thing, but it isn't sanctified yet. All the things that they have are not sanctified, and the only way they could be sanctified is by anointing them with this special oil that the Bible talks about in Leviticus, about how to build this oil. And this oil is not to be used on human beings. The anointing that they're going to do from the red heifer ashes and those things, they'll do that on the people, but it is not the same. In fact, they are forbidden to use their anointing oil for the objects on people. It's not allowed. So one of the plants for that anointing oil had went extinct, and they were doing an archaeological dig, and they found two cruses of that oil with a seal on them. And this oil is 2,000 years old. They tested it, and it's still pure. It hasn't gone rancid. Right. That means there's a blessing from God on that. That's not natural.
Anointed.
Yeah. The oil is anointed, and so they're going to use that oil to anoint the menorah. They built a menorah replica. And the menorah was taken in battle, and there's carvings of it in Rome where they brought it in. So they built a new one. The old one may have been melted down. Who knows? Maybe the Roman Catholic Church has it now. I don't know. They really lost track of it, as well as the Ark of the Covenant. So they're saying that they've built a brand new menorah, and I think it's like 90 pounds of gold or something. 98 pounds is heavy of gold. And then they're going to anoint that. They're going to anoint Aaron's robe, and he's got a turban that he wears, and then on top of that is a crown that the scripture details when Moses was commanded to build these things. So all those items have to be anointed, and they have the table for the showbread, and they have, you know, all the different pieces that they need. They have these special knives for making the sacrifice with. And all those things have to be anointed. So they have this oil now, which they didn't have before, and there was no chance of it had they not found these two cruses, because this plant has went extinct. And then in this last year and a half or 2 years, they found, you know, they've been buying the blue that they put on their, they wear a tzitzit, which is like a kind of like a little smock looking thing, and it has four strings, one on each corner, and that's what's required for Jews to wear that are in the faith. And they've been dyeing those strings with this Russian blue color, which they thought was the correct color. And then some Jewish man was fishing, and he caught some type of a snail, and they have this blue dye in them. And they found that that is the actual original blue dye that the priest used to dye those strings on those. So now they have that. I mean, piece by piece, all those things are coming together so that they can have a proper temple and do worship the way that they did back when Christ was here. You know, and they haven't had the Ark of the Covenant has been missing for about 400 years before Christ. So even when Jesus went to the temple, the ark was not there. They say that Jeremiah took it and hid it during the Babylonian siege of Jerusalem. So,
do you think they'll start using that again on current wars, as they would put it in front of them in battle in the Old Testament? Do you think?
Yeah, I don't know what they would do, because it's such a rare relic. You know, they wouldn't want anything to happen, but unless it had that power. But you know, they're saying, from what I heard, there's a guy that, I know this is a little bit off, it's kind of on the subject, but a little bit off. They found, there's an archaeological dig in Shiloh, and that is where the original tabernacle was. The tabernacle that Moses had constructed, and that was made out of, there was some gold and things like that in it, but a lot of it was acacia wood and skins of animals and linen and things like that, right? And so these guys found the actual place where they believed that this the Ark of the Covenant set. There's a cutout in the floor that is the shape of the Ark. And they found stones that somebody put there and smoothed out, and there were places for the poles to go in because the original skin building had so many poles, and they were connected by these loops of metal that were coated with gold, or they were brass, and they this thing was portable, but it set for 400 years in Shiloh, and they found pomegranates that were carved out of ivory and things like this. And we know that pomegranate was on Aaron's robe. And so they're pretty much positive this is where the Ark of the Covenant was and the original tabernacle. And in this discovery, you know, they found that in Egypt, there's a stone. There were two men in the Old Testament that God said, these two men, and he named them off, and he named their fathers off also, and he said, these two men are experts in stone craftsmanship and working with materials and with gold, and I want you to make them, use them to make these things that I've shown you when you were on the mountain, and that was the, you know, the Ark of the Covenant and the Table of Showbread and the Tabernacle and all the things that God needed for his worship. And so, you know, they found a stone in Egypt with those two guys' names on it, and it says that they worked in gold and in materials. So, and it's in Egyptian. So we know that those two men existed, that the Old Testament is true, right down to the names of these men that worked on the tabernacle.
It's incredible. So,
it is. It really, and they're finding all these things right here at the end. You know, there's been archaeological work done there since the 1800s and earlier, but yet after all those years, they just now are able to find these things, you know, these stones and with these men's name on them. And it says, yeah, this guy's an expert in this craft. And he's the one that Moses writes about. And then they found early Hebrew writing, because, you know, a lot of times scholars were saying, well, Moses couldn't have wrote the Old Testament, the first five books, because if he was really raised as a Egyptian, they wrote in hieroglyphs, and it would take volumes and volumes to do one book of pictures. And so they found the beginnings of the Hebrew alphabet. And so, you know, that is more proof that Moses actually wrote it. He wrote it in that alphabet language that they were developing as Hebrews while they were in captivity. They were developing a written language.
Wow.
It's just,
like you said, they're all lining up. Like, all these finds are lining up with the arrival of the Antichrist, the rapture, the wars, Israel being surrounded. It's all lining up. The love of many waxing cold. It's literally like we're in that time. I'm convinced of it. We're in that time.
Oh, yeah. It has to be, because, you know, never before in history have we had all these things occurring. Just think about this. I mean, just in the natural world, 80 years ago, if they would have said, yeah, we're gonna build a machine out of steel and it's going to go to the moon, and men are going to land on the moon and walk around on the moon and bring back pieces of the moon. You know, the Saturn V rocket was like, it weighed 2.6 million pounds. And it reached a speed of five times faster than a bullet out of a rifle in that 80-year period. You know, just in 1969, they landed on the moon. It's just unbelievable where we've came from. You know, just 45 years before that, people were driving around Model A's and things. There was no, you know, there was radio, there was no television, there were none of these modern conveniences, you know, refrigeration, all these things that have came to pass just in the past few years are just mind-blowing. And, you know, the scripture tells us about when the two witnesses are killed that the whole world rejoices, right? And during the time of Christ, it would take you 2 or 3 weeks just to get someplace, and that wasn't even the edge of the empire. Imagine trying to spread the knowledge of the death of somebody. You know, I think one of the emperors of Rome died, and it took them 2 or 3 weeks to get out to the battlefield to tell the guys, hey, it's over, you know? So modern technology really has made possible the very things that the scripture has talked about in the Old Testament and in the words of Christ about what will happen at the end, you know, in John's revelation about the Lord returning and what will happen to the people that are, you know, here to face the Antichrist.
And Daniel, knowledge shall increase. Boy, I mean, they got... Knowledge is so increased right now. They got this AI chatbot thing that keeps trying to show up on different things I do, even like on a search, on an internet search. It'll want to search for you, and you can chat with it and stuff. And like, it's just open doors. It's open doors. It's beginning the communication. Beginning the communication towards the Antichrist.
That's well, you know, now the Minister Paul, they want you to, they'll have a little box and it'll say, to help us refine this research, would you put down, you know, say exactly what you're looking for? And they're using an AI to look at that and analyze that and put that into their database. Like you're talking about, it's just, you know, I was watching a guy yesterday a little bit, and he was using AI to do a painting. He was reading Bible scriptures, and he was reading the scriptures about when Jesus and the disciples were in the boat, right? And he had fallen asleep and the waves came. And so they were doing that, and it depicted Christ as, you know, in one of the pictures as having a bunch of teeth, like a circular amount of teeth. And there was like 3 or 4 Jesuses and things like that. So you wonder, like, where does this thing get this idea of what Christ would look like? Because he was dressed like Christ. You know, he had a burgundy-colored robe with a gold sash on it. And he was wearing, you know, like a tan-colored tunic or whatever. So you wonder, and he had a beard and longer hair. So, you wonder, where are these machines getting these ideas about what is Jesus? Somebody has to be talking to them, you know, inputting this data, saying, look, there, Jesus Christ was a man with a beard and long hair, and he wore this and that, so that it could, you know, draw these images. So
it's interesting you mentioned that, because late yesterday, I read that a guy asked the chatbot, it's one particular one. I can't think of its name right now, but it's one particular one. And he asked it to take over and destroy the world. Wow. I kid you not, he said it began to tweet things to pit Christians against non-Christians. It began to search the internet for nuclear weapons and how they work. It just took off and started figuring out how to take over and end the world.
Oh, no.
It was tweeting. It was searching. It was looking up nukes.
Yeah. Well, you know, Minister Paul, I was watching, I watch this guy, he's called Canadian Prepper every now and then. And he was talking about
Chat Twitter. GPT, they said in the chat. Chat GPT.
Chat GPT. And then he was talking about Twitter and the algorithm they use, and they use an algorithm to, they want to cause They want to cause some kind of friction, and so that there's an upset, so that people gather to that, and like, you know, maybe it starts with two or three people or four people, and then it, you know, it's like a fire. You've got to, when you make a campfire, you've got to start out small and get it to build before you can actually put logs on it. So, you know, this thing is doing something similar to that with people on Twitter, trying to get them to, I mean, not Twitter, but TikTok, and it's trying to get them to get something started and then start adding coal to that fire to get it going. And it's all in this, it's a robotic thing. It's an algorithm, just like, you know, what you're talking about. So it's very frightening. And we know that at some point the Antichrist builds an image, and somehow he has power to give that image life, and that image is in the temple. So who knows what this could be.
Like, you know, a hologram, be, Project Bluebeam.
Right. There's
so many different ways now.
Yeah, it could be a robot. It could be, I mean.
A robot.
Right.
Even a citizen robot like Saudi Arabia did. They made an artificial robot, intelligence robot, a citizen,
right,
of the country.
You know, and the Bible tells us that the Nephilim are going to return during that time. That just precedes this. They will be back again, Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah. So will it be in the days that the Son of Man returns. So we know that there were Nephilim then. There were these fallen ones. And, you know, at some point it talks about Satan falling from the heavens like lightning. And, you know, maybe that's what's going on. And they have all these ideas. They have technology. And they know they have all this, they have power. They understand gravity. They understand science a lot deeper than we do. So who knows what they do, you know, what they're doing. They could have spacecraft. They could even be these so-called aliens, you know. And who knows what kind of technology he has. We know that in the book of Enoch, it talks about him making many forms and inhabiting them. In the scriptures, on several times, they quote from Enoch. So we know that Enoch, the book of Enoch, had some validity. And they have a copy of Enoch that's found in the Dead Sea Scrolls that is 200 years before Christ. So somebody was maintaining that book because they believed it was valuable. It wasn't put into the canon of scripture, because there's so many things they said that, you know, it's, they even debated about putting the book of the Revelation in there, because it was just over the top, you know, and they thought it might frighten people. And they thought, you know, they had all these fears about this information that would come out from it.
There's a Google engineer that was fired, and then Trump pardoned him, and he created a artificial intelligence where the only thing he loaded in it was the King James Bible, and he set it in a church. It's called The Way, and he ran a church. He let this artificial intelligence run a church.
Oh wow.
Hey, we just hit, let me see, we're at 93 people. Seven. Wow. If a couple people hit the like button or share this or post it on Facebook, hit 100 people, that would be awesome, wouldn't it? Shout out to the chat room. Huh?
We're not very far from that.
No, yes. 96.
Yeah.
Triple digits if we hit it. Hey, yeah. Sister Michelle. And we've got people from all over the world. Sister Ruth Keene, Sharon Belfield, rest a while, y'all. And I'm glad, Michelle, you got the audio working again. We have Sharon Delaney from Ireland and Patricia from Ireland and Trisha Cucciero just giving some shouts out here.
Yes, amen.
Hit the like button. Go ahead, Brother Gary.
So, you know, when we look at all these things with the temple and what Christ said, we know that that there's going to be this another temple built there, and this third temple, and the Antichrist. You see the scripture, you know, you and I have talked about this, and the scripture tells us that the Antichrist really is ruling the world from Jerusalem or somewhere in Israel. The Bible tells us that he is the one that causes both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark. All people to receive this mark.
I have that scripture.
Yeah.
I'll bring it up.
If you want, but you know, that's the thing. We have evidence that shows that the United States of America isn't running the world. The Antichrist is not running the world from America or from Britain or from Russia or China. He's running it from Israel. That's where the two witnesses are. That's where the 144,000 are. We know that the 144,000 will be witnessing from there. And at some point, you know, in the very beginning, everything's going to look good. This man's going to look like a savior to them. He's going to look like a positive thing that's happening. And at some point, he flips a switch and he goes in there and declares, you know, he becomes full of himself. His ego takes over, and then he reveals who he really is, you know, and the Jewish people flee. So.
An interesting fact about that, a little factoid, is it says, pray that your flight may not be in winter or on the Sabbath. And everyone may not know that on the Sabbath, they would lock the gates and close the gates so people couldn't wander around and stuff. And that's why you would have been basically on a lockdown.
Yeah, exactly.
On the Sabbath. Everything he said is just so precise and holy, and I just love him. I'm glad we're doing this today.
Mr. Paul, too, the thing is, look how it's put together. People put the scriptures together hundreds of years ago, the King James Version, and they arranged these books in a way, you know, and I don't know that they were truly aware. They had to be led by the Holy Spirit to do this. You know, because the way they build upon each other and the whole system that it goes by and how it backs itself up all the way through, it's just mind-blowing. So Daniel 11:31 says, and arms shall stand on his part, and they shall pollute the sanctuary of strength, and they shall take away the daily sacrifice, and they shall place the abomination that makes desolate. So we have...
What are the verses in that 11? I have it up right now.
This is Daniel 11:31.
31.
And they're talking about... Yeah, he's talking about what is going to happen in the future. We know that this happened once before, but Jesus said it's going to happen again. So the Antichrist himself will take human form. He will be, I believe that, you know, we know the devil is going to incarnate into a human being somehow. That's his whole goal, you know, to be one of us, to rule us, to be worshipped by the human race.
So the Antichrist spirit is going to enter a man just like it entered Judas.
Right, exactly.
In a similar manner to that, right?
Yeah.
Do you think, we haven't talked about this, but do you think it's possible for the Antichrist spirit to go into this man during this period, say like Hitler? Because it says many Antichrist spirits are
open. Right.
And then to like go into this man, and then like it could literally move around till it's finally in its final place, or do you think it's just entered and stays?
I agree with you. He's mobile, and it's kind of like the Matrix, when Agent Smith can be anybody. He can be the helicopter pilot. He can be the little lady, old lady walking down the street. This Antichrist spirit can be anybody. You know, At one point, Agent Smith becomes that bum in the railway system underground that's sleeping, you know? And so, you know, Satan himself, this spirit of his, you know, we know that God physically grabs them at the end and casts them into the lake of fire. So they must have a physicality to them.
That's right.
You know, at some point, so.
And drags them down to the pit.
Right.
For 1,000 years. Yeah, there have to be something to grab.
Yeah, exactly. And we know also that there are angels chained, physically chained underneath the Euphrates River, which is drying up. And the scripture tells us that when it dries up, at some point, an angel pours a bowl on it and they're released. And they come out and they begin to kill people. So, you know, all of these things are pointing towards the end of time. We see this river drying up. And look at the judgments on California and the government that this state has. Of first, there's drought and fires. And then all of a sudden, it's really cold and raining and it's flooding. All the dams are about to break. And just
pestilence, you know, earthquakes.
Right.
The one thing we haven't got is a big earthquake, which I know and I have both seen.
Yeah.
A 9.1, I think. Both.
Yeah. Yep. There, that's next. You know, and I prayed about that when I had that dream about the earthquake. And I said, Lord, are you really telling me there's going to be an earthquake here? And I'd lived, you know, in this area for years and never experienced an earthquake. And that night at around 10:30, there was a 3 on the Richter scale earthquake about less than a mile from my house. And it was underneath a mountain that doesn't even have a fault line. And the USGS was like, we don't understand how this can happen. Why is there an earthquake centered right here where there's no fault line?
Wow.
It woke me up. And so, you know, that is amazing. So I really believe, you know, when they were having those earthquakes that hit over by China Lake and all that, I really thought maybe it's going to happen now, you know, because this was pretty severe. They shook this house where we are. And so I was thinking, well, maybe it's building up to that, you know, and a lot of people were very worried, you know, that there could be a major, you know, they're talking about a slip that can happen and it moves it close to the speed of sound, and it really will destroy a lot of the cities. And maybe that's what, you know, there's so many Christians that had dreams about California, pieces of it sliding into the ocean, or this huge earthquake and these things happening. And really, you know, that could cause that to happen, something like that, this super fast snap of this, you know, shock. There hasn't been one on the San Andreas.
A strike slip, is that what they call that? Strip fault.
Right.
I believe.
And that's what they're looking to, you know, and maybe that's what people saw, you know, for Los Angeles and for a lot of the cities. And in fact, what I saw was the bridges, older part of the city, those bridges had fallen down and they were laying on the roadway. Things like that is what I saw in the dream that I had. So, and then I had, you know, 2 more confirmation dreams, plus that earthquake happened up here after I asked the Lord, you know, and that bit the first earthquake in like, I don't know, 15 years at the time or 14 years. I'd never experienced one up here. When I lived in Bakersfield, I felt a few earthquakes, but I've never felt one. Well, we live up here.
Oh, we feel down here. Gail and I ran out of the house on one, 5.7 north of us. We went over 100 people.
Yeah. Wow, that's great.
We did it.
That's it, man.
Thank you, Jesus.
You got to open it up more. So let's talk a little bit about, since we talked about the temple, we know that this is a high possibility. As far as earthly eyes look, we know the scripture tells us this is going to happen, so there's no way to stop it. But we can see these men working for the power of God to get this done. That's what's amazing. they go, well, we need this special anointing oil in the plant that we need to make the mixture is extinct. Oh, look, we discovered the oil. You know, it's just, I mean, who could predict that would happen, that they would find two cruises that had high priest steals on them saying these are kosher.
Wow.
You know, for 2,000 years buried, and they find them and they're perfectly good. They haven't went rancid or anything. You know, most oil, keep olive oil or any other oil for a couple of years and find out what it's like, you know?
2,000 years.
2,000 years they were buried and they find them. And then...
So they have pretty much everything they need to set this off with the Antichrist, right? The system, everything in place.
Everything is in place. In fact, the rapture can happen. I believe it can happen any time. I mean, I believe in the immediacy of it, that any moment. It's only dependent on what God's time frame is, you know, because, you know, a lot of people think, well, God is waiting to do this, this, and this, or whatever. But really, I believe, as the book of Daniel tells us in the ninth chapter, you know, there's the revelation of the 70 weeks. And so what that tells you is that God has a timeline, that this thing isn't all dependent on you or me or anybody. Really, God has a timeline, and God causes these men to... I feel the Holy Spirit, brother.
Me too, like, strong.
Yeah, real powerful right now. He is orchestrating this, and he is causing these men, just like he says in the Word, that he is the one that sets up princes. He's the one that sets up kingdoms. He's the one that puts up rulers. Joe Biden is in the presidency because God wanted it that way. Because if he didn't, he wouldn't be in there. And Joe Biden is doing those things that are necessary to set this country up for judgment. Because God, hallelujah.
For I will not forsake you. I am coming. I am coming. Look for me. I will not forsake you. Have I not promised? Have I not said it? Am I not I am?
Glory to God. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, I was going to say, he talks about his cup of wrath being full. You know, and you can do this little experiment at home. You can take a cup and fill it all the way up to the very top and then just keep adding a little bit. And you'll see that water rises up above the top of the cup. And then you add one more drop, and all of that that's above it just rushes over. And that is the wrath of God. And to fill that cup to overflowing, is we needed Biden in there. We needed a man that was going to do whatever had to be done for the Antichrist and the Antichrist system so that God can accomplish this thing that he's going to accomplish. And Donald Trump was doing all these things that were good for the nation, that were protecting businesses. He isn't perfect. He isn't a God or any of those kind of things. He doesn't need to be worshipped, but he did a really good job while he was in there at trying to fix our economy and trying to do all these things that made him an enemy of those people.
And Biden, you know, still won.
What's that?
And Biden still won.
Yeah, exactly. 80 million people voted for him, they said.
That's what they say.
That's unbelievable that that many people would choose that over this. So we know that God, through his word, he demonstrated over and over again that he knows the future. You know, he talked about Cyrus. 150 years or more before Cyrus was born, and just on and on and on and on in the scripture. And we know these things are true because they found the Dead Sea Scrolls. Think about that. In 1947, a Bedouin kid's out there doing his shepherding. He sees an animal that's predatory, so he throws a rock and hears a vase break. He goes up there and looks, and there's these big pottery vases full of scrolls. And those are the very scrolls that back up the Bible, and they test them through, they've got all these newer methods using light to check dates and stuff, and they've found these things are, you know, 2,400 years old and 2,200 years old. They have a copy of Isaiah that's identical to our copy in the King James Bible. It's identical to it, and it's 2,400 and some years old.
Wow.
You know, that is just...
That right there should be enough to wake up Jewish people, and yet people don't understand. They're blinded.
Yeah.
You know, we pray for them and pray for them, but they're blinded.
The 53rd chapter is off limits for them to read because it talks about Christ and the piercing and all this. And then they try to make up some gobbledygook. And when you really look at the words and the context, there's no way that it can be interpreted any other way than what it, the way that Christians interpret it. You know, these rabbis, they want to stick with their old dried up religion that's dead. You know, that's really what they want to do. They want to bring back that old sacrificial system. They say they believe, right? And in their religion, it tells them that a Messiah is coming. That's why those wise men were looking for Christ, the Messiah, the Redeemer, the one that was called to come. Why were they looking? Because they read the Jewish scriptures that told them, this guy's coming. He's going to be born. They're probably reading Daniel. You
know, so Daniel just talked. As, brother, just as Christ fulfilled, he's the only one that could have fulfilled all of Isaiah. He's the only candidate. Just like that, do you think the Antichrist is going to come in? And we have tidbits of him in Daniel and Revelation. And the tribe we'll talk about.
Yeah.
He's going to fulfill those things also. He's a counterfeit. He just counterfeits everything Jesus does. Exactly. But people will believe because we forget. There's going to be a strong delusion, and God will said even the very elect could be fooled if possible.
Right. Exactly. You're exactly right. He's going to fulfill all of those things that are written about him in the scripture.
There's people that are doing that now, even starting to fulfill.
That up. Yeah, 100%. So, what do we know about the Antichrist? You know, the Bible gives us his attributes, what he's going to do, you know, what is he going to accomplish, you know, and from Daniel, as we just talked about, you know, he's going to do these things to the sanctuary. And he's going to stop the daily sacrifice. And he's going to set up a kingdom of his own. And that kingdom is going to be an opposite, a mirror image of Christ's kingdom. You know, he's going to have a false prophet. And this thing is going to be powerful. And people are going to, as you said, the scripture plainly tells us that a strong delusion is coming. And that if it wasn't for the power of God, the saints themselves that are left at the time would fall for it. You know, this is going to be this huge lie. It's going to be a world lie, and people are going to buy into it. Look at what they're buying into right now, Mr. Paul. You know, 4 years ago, there was never, if you would have said 4 years ago, oh yeah, there's going to be a new president, and he's going to make it his main focus and objective to turn kids that are in kindergarten and first to second grade from a boy into a girl, or a girl into a boy. Nobody would believe that. And that's going to be taught in school. And if you're a parent and you object to it, they're going to try to make laws that will allow them to prosecute you.
Good is, Biden just sealed that up yesterday with some type of order. Yes, just yesterday. He made sure of that. Yeah. And, they call evil good and good evil. and that's here now. We, you know, 20 years ago would be like, oh yeah, look at this. But today there's so much evil that people, it's unsafe to walk in certain cities. You know, someone was stabbed to death right in San Francisco. The owner of Cash App, do you hear about that? He was stabbed multiple times and was crying out for help. People are going around and knocking each other out. The love of many is waxed cold. That's another sign. That's another sign that we know how close we are. It's the Antichrist spirit, like beginning to set in, and the restrainer will stop restraining. And makes me think of 2 Thessalonians 2.
Yes, it is.
About how he'll be revealed. I can bring that up.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. You know, and it talks about that mystery of iniquity and how it was working at that time that Paul had wrote 2 Thessalonians, and it's going to keep moving forward. And that's what we see. Like, I'm shocked about this whole school system thing, where especially California is super liberal and they are pushing this agenda, and these people aren't just getting a job and working, they're pushing an agenda, you know, like in governmental positions, they're using that power and authority to push their will and their thinking upon everybody else, this a minority, and they want to use laws to try to stop you from exercising your free speech, and to also, you know, eventually they're going to try to ban the Bible. That's what I think, you know, because it speaks out against all of these behaviors. And, you know, Biden was talking in this one particular speech where he was talking about these children and how it's a sin to stop them from you know, a lot of little boys will wear a little girl's dress, or they'll play with a little girl's doll or something to that effect, and they see that in school, and they start thinking, well, maybe little Johnny wants to be a girl. Do you want to be a little girl? Well, sure, I do. Well, okay, now we got to hide this from the parent, and we're going to have to do drug interdiction, and we'll stop his hormones from kicking in, and we'll turn him into a girl. And if the parents are kept out of the loop, and that is what they want. They want these things which were unspeakable just 4 years ago. You know, you never thought of that. I never heard a thing about it. You know, you heard of an oddball thing like maybe Bruce Jenner. You know, the guy that I'd be eating my Wheaties in the morning, and he would be on there throwing a javelin or running.
Olympic.
A hero.
Olympian.
Yeah. He was an American hero in there. And Bruce Jenner. And then you find out he became a woman.
And now...
But she's got long hair and certain other things. I don't know how much transition he's made. And you see so many people that do these transitions that commit suicide afterwards. That's why Jordan Peterson is against these type of behaviors, because as a psychologist, he's seen 100,000 people, and he sees all these people's lives that have been destroyed, you know, while this stuff is occurring. So,
you know, it's an agenda. I mean, it's a complete agenda. Just like when Obama changed the sanctity of marriage to just you could marry anybody, it's the same exact thing. It's an attack on women. And so we pray for the women, and we just cover them with our prayers. They just made a man woman of the year.
I know. That's
they made a man woman of the year, biological male, and they call him she. There's an MMA fighter who's broken two skulls of women because he's fighting as a woman, but he's a man with man's strength. It's brutal. It's their new agenda. And like you said, the President Biden backs it and supports it.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a sign. Let it be for a sign.
Exactly. And, you know, as I was talking earlier, that's why I'm talking about this cup of wrath that's being, it's being filled, you know, incremental, to a point to where it just is gonna, God is gonna have enough, and then judgment's coming. You know, and you and I have talked about this and about the possibility was God had shown me of nuclear strikes on the United States of America, Russia, and China, and something to do with Iran. The Lord had shown me that there would be a war that's triggered because of Ukraine. And I dreamed this, you know, years ago, and I made a video about it. And what the Lord showed me was just outside of Ukraine, NATO forces were attacked. And like 3,200 or 500 of them, between 3,500 and 3,200 were killed. And this was a trigger of, you know, a nuclear war. And it was just outside of Ukraine. And then that is now happening. You know, we see Russia moved nuclear weapons into Belarus, and they're targeting NATO forces. Tactical nuclear weapons are targeting NATO forces. Right now, as we speak, Russia's lost about 50% of their tanks have been destroyed. They're using equipment from the 60s now. And then they've had all these planes shot down, like 40-something percent of their planes. Even their strategic bombers, two or three of those were damaged. And we are giving – there was a red line that Putin had talked about in regard to weapons that we give to Ukraine to defend themselves with, even though Ukraine is supposedly a sovereign nation, Russia's attacking them like a bunch of pirates. But they said no tanks and no planes. And now – there's F-16s, which are way better than the Su-29s that the Russians have. They have three times the range. They can fly 1,400 miles, those Russian Su-29s, 400-something miles, and they can carry more weapons. They have better guidance systems. They have munitions that are laser-guided and everything else that Russia does not have. So now they've trained 16 pilots to fly these or more, plus they've shipped the 16 planes over there. And then we're moving M1 Abrams tanks over there, and they're going to use depleted uranium rounds on these guys. So Russia said, well, you're using wet nuclear on us. You're using depleted uranium. So we're going to move nuclear weapons. And it's just a matter of time. I believe, you know, with these planes, they've flown those Russian old drones, and then they found inside of them whenever they detonated after they hit their targets, there were pieces of American gear in there that helped those drones guide them right to a Russian target. You know, and then the Moskov, like you and I were talking about, the flagship of Russia. That would be like somebody destroying the Gerald Ford supercarrier. That would be infuriating. So they blow the Moskov up with those Neptune sea missiles, and then they blew the other ship that they have that's the same as the Moskov, and the Lord had shown me in a dream that something to do with that Moskov triggered this war. So there's things, you know, like we talked about, you know, a camel and the straw that broke its back. You know, there's just these things that just keep getting laid on top of Putin until the point, you know, he's not right by what he's doing at no stretch of the imagination, but he's a person that's armed with nuclear weapons and tactical nuclear weapons, and that seems to be the only thing that they have that works, maybe. So, you know, Russia has submarines and those. I think you and I and Patrick, a bunch of us got this Event Horizon word from the Lord, which is what they're calling that nuclear submarine, the submarine that they have. It's a diesel electric sub. You cannot track it. NATO's tried. They're impossible because they're super quiet. The only time you know they're there is when they launch the missiles. So imagine, you know, they've got a fleet of those running around. They could be preparing right now to attack the United States of America and our allies.
Belgorod
also. I also got that word too. And that's the ship that Putin goes on, is the Belgorod. And it's a nuclear SLBM launch submarine, so sea launched ballistic missile submarine. It's just, you know, who knows what's going to trigger this guy to do whatever he's going to do. And the fact is, you know, this is all part of, really, I see it as all Bible prophecy with the coming of the Antichrist there has to be a destruction of the current world order for him to emplace his new world order. It's going to come out and they're going to, you know, have the 10 nations or 10 categories of nations, whoever survived. And America cannot be the leader of that. We know that. How would you have a world leader that imposed their system on us to make us all take marks of the beast if, and that person's in Jerusalem ruling from the temple and all that? How would that be? You know, it's something's got to happen to bring us down to, it's got to level the whole playing field for everybody in the world. And then we're going to have the Antichrist appear, you know, and he's going to try to be this guy that puts everything together.
Do we have any idea what tribe the Antichrist might come out of?
Yes. The scripture tells us. Yeah, there's popular belief that he comes from the tribe of Dan. And there are,
I got the scripture up. It's Genesis 49, 16, and 17.
Right. There's Genesis, and then, let's see, where's my notes here? I can't seem to see that. I can't see it over here. And there was Deuteronomy 33, I believe, they use, and Revelation. And, you know, they describe him, modern, you know, Christianity, when they're doing these trainings, you know, teaching preachers, they talk about him, and they use those scriptures to really push forward the idea that he would be from the tribe of Dan. And
many scholars agree also, from what I understand.
Many. But, you know, there's another side to that coin. And the thing is, you know, Mr. Paul Patrick and I have talked about this, Pastor Patrick and I, about, you know, who he would be and all this stuff, you know, and there's one candidate that we do know of that meets some of these criteria about Dan. And the scripture used is in Genesis 49, Jacob, as father, he was aging at the time, you know, and he was beginning to bless the 12 sons that he had. And so when he was speaking these blessings over his sons, he came to Dan, and he says in verse 16 and 17, Dan shall judge his people as one of the tribes of Israel. Dan shall be a serpent by the way, a viper, by the viper in the path that bites the horse's heels so that the rider shall fall backwards. That's one reason right there that they think, you see, it refers to him as the serpent.
Which is always, in the Holy Word, that's always demons and devils.
Right. Or Satan himself in the garden came as a serpent to Eve. So, you know, they're making this leap of faith, really. And then in Deuteronomy 33, it says, now this is the blessing Moses gave before his death in verse 22. And Dan, he said, Dan is a lion's whelp. He shall leap from Bashan. And when they look at these older maps you can look at of Israel, you can see Dan was in one area given to him by the scriptures, and then he moved. He did indeed move upwards to the place that's called Dan right now. And in fact, they have a Intel Dan. They have one of the oldest doorways and archways ever in history. They believe it goes back to the time of Abraham. I think you might have a picture of that you can share.
I'm putting it up. And I'm bringing it up. I'm putting the picture up, and I'm bringing up Revelation 7 also, that talks about the 12 tribes. So they get a visual. Our wonderful audience, our brothers and sisters in Christ. It says Revelation chapter 7 talks about the 144,000 men sealed, 12,000 men from each tribe. Judah, Reuben, Gad, Asher, Naphtali, Manasseh, Simeon, Levi, Issachar, Zebulun, Joseph, and Benjamin. So now Dan's not mentioned there, right?
No, he's not. Not at all. That's one of the other great points that they bring home, because when the two witnesses are there and they have these 144,000 men who are virgins, 12,000 from each tribe, that is one tribe that is not mentioned, because all the other evidence kind of points to the fact that he does these things that are wrong, serpent-like things, where he attacks the heel of the horse and causes the rider to fall backwards off, as it talks about in Genesis 49. So, you know, there are many little things, and those are the three ones that most churches agree, well, it's got to be Dan. And, you know, there is a president that we had that really fits that category. And Obama, you know, he was named, now I'm not saying he is the Antichrist, but you know, the Lord had shown me, and I know he's showed you and several other people, dreams that really lead us to believe this man could be it. And one of the reasons that you could think that would be, you know, he is a man of peace, and we know that this Antichrist figure is going to be somebody that unifies people. He's going to be maybe portrayed as a peaceful man. But we also know that during Obama's presidency, he attacked 7 countries. He bombed them. So, and this is a man with a Nobel Peace Prize,
bombing 7 countries.
He killed Osama bin Laden. He killed people that opposed him personally, people that talked about rumors about him being a homosexual. Every person but one that was involved in that has died an untimely death. And so, you know, you wonder, did he have a hand in this? Was he part of it? Why did these people in particular who were connected to him die when they were making these reports? We know that just recently, this is what really spurred this whole meeting too, was the fact that, you know, you were talking to me about him being the envoy to Kenya. And it started me thinking, you know, Kenya is part of the old Roman Empire, which the Bible says that these scholars are all talking about him being from Dan and being part of the old Roman Empire. So we know that Kenya was part of that at some point. And that's really, his father's from that area. And he's got roots there with relatives. And he'd written that book where he talks about this leopard, and I know you had a dream about a leopard and him together. So
I did. I could explain.
You want to tell a little bit about that?
Yeah, I could tell. I had two dreams about Obama, and one of them he turns to a leopard, and there's scripture that bears witness of that. So I'm in the Rose Garden at the White House, and Obama's wearing all black. And there's another man right next to him, and he's wearing all white. And as I approach him, this feeling, every time I've dreamed about Obama, it's rage and anger and hatred and fury and mayhem directed at me, like these evil spirits just emanating out of him, directing me out. And I'm like, the Lord Jesus Christ rebuke you. And Obama, he drops down and morphs into a leopard and runs off. And even the leopard, I want to say this, even the leopard had the same spirits that was just angry and hatred. Yeah. That was one dream. In a second dream, and I have 89 videos of Obama I just checked this morning. There has to be for a reason. I've never dreamed anybody else like this. I was going to an ATM machine. And Obama appears in front of me and he says, you can only buy cakes and ice cream. And all this is documented like years ago, so people know.
Yeah.
You can only buy cookies. It was cookies and milk. You can only buy cookies and milk. And I looked at him and he says, and he blocks me from approaching the ATM. And it was like a run on money and everybody needed money. And he blocks me from the ATM. And he says, I only barter in silver and gold. I only barter in silver and gold.
That's amazing.
And you have to wonder why, because I know those dreams are for the Lord. I don't even need my notes. I can remember them. Why would I have 89 videos on Obama? Well, I mean, it's profound.
The other thing is, too, that's kind of key. I don't know if you thought about this, but you know, they're talking about, like, whenever, right now, they're talking about trying to digitize money so that it's like Bitcoin or something. So there won't be any dollar bills. There won't be any paper money. So the only other thing people could use would be silver and gold.
Wow. That's and the Holy Spirit did reveal to me that the reason that it was cookies and milk is, he said, government control. They will literally control what you can and can't buy, is what that meant in my dream.
Yeah, that's just mind-blowing, you know? And so we also know that through the scriptures that, you know, this Dan person, Obama, fits it very well because from what I understand, Obama's mother is related to Princess Diana, and both of them are from the tribe of Dan.
Wow.
So here's this Dan connection to Obama. And we know this. It says that in the scripture that the ones that destroy it will be the ones that destroyed it before, right? The Romans destroyed the temple before. And so this Antichrist that destroys all these things, he comes from that. And we know that the Britain is part of the Roman Empire, and that at one time Kenya was part of that. America was a British colony. It's default part of the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire flag that is carried into battle is a pole with a brass or gold eagle on top. The United States flag is a pole with an eagle on top of it. So, you know, these things are being carried on for 2,000 years now. We know that there's a lot about America that is very much like the Roman Empire. And so he comes from this country as well as coming from Britain, his parents, his lineage. So he could very well be the, you know, the person.
Rumored to be a homosexual, and those aren't my words. Just do an internet search.
Right.
They claim his wife is a man. I mean, it's a huge
thing. Yes, it is.
It's not a small thing.
Right, he fits that category of who the Antichrist is. You know, it talks about he will not be really influenced or swayed by a woman. And so a lot of people have thought, well, maybe, you know, one of the ultimate things that Satan is a rebellious creature. And so you would naturally think he would rebel in all ways, like what's going on now. You cannot procreate if there's two people of the same sex. And that was one of the things that God commanded Adam and Eve to do as soon as they were put out. So, you know, that just the whole sexuality thing is part of this whole description of who he is. And he, you know, he is, like you said, there's been many pictures of his wife. They can't find him. I understand they can't find any pictures of their children when they were very little, like babies or in...
her pregnant? You know, have you ever seen a picture of her pregnant?
Yeah, there's none.
One more thing is, and people know this who listen to our channels, a blue O appeared on my hand. Did you know that? This blue O literally appeared on my hand. And I there's video of it. It's like a 2-minute video where I'm shaking and I'm in my prayer closet and I close the door and I'm staring at filming it. I'm, what is this, Lord? And I saw in a vision Obama being dragged straight to hell. I'll go that far as to say I think he is the Antichrist. That's why I asked, can he move around and stuff? Because who else is fitting? Who else is fitting all these things? And we know there's three beasts.
Yes.
Right? Because some people want to put Trump in that category because of the Abraham Accords. Well, if he came back and confirmed. So, like I said, I'm on the record of making 89 videos that I believe Obama's the Antichrist. I'm just speaking for myself, not Gary. So there's no doubt in me, but people can be wrong. You know, Jesus said, take heed, no man deceive you. But it's like Isaiah being fulfilled, except in the opposite, in the evil fashion, like he has his own Bible somewhere. He probably does have his own, the satanic Bible, where everything's opposite. You know, these things are lining up and fitting and fitting and fitting. And people say, well, Obama hasn't been in office for years. Why is he going to Kenya? Is he trying to escape prosecution? Or, you know, he sees Trump getting prosecuted and he's guilty of even more. It's another thing, is he's guilty of crimes.
Oh, yeah. Well, he knew that it was his Department of Justice that was prosecuting this thing against Trump and with these illegal things that they were saying that he did. He knew that the document, the Steele document and all that, was phony. He was working with that. In fact, I'd had a dream, about Trump being the nominee and everything. And I had a second dream after that. And I posted both these dreams also, where I saw Hillary and Obama at the presidential podium. And they were talking about how they could influence or win an election. And one of them was through the computers. And that when it does the handshake, they could inject votes in there. And then there was another way by like ballot box stuffing some way. They could do something with the actual box and the votes. And the third way, he said, but I couldn't understand what he said, what that third way was. But then afterwards, I heard the words utter corruption, and just a feeling of disgust over what they were planning. And I didn't really fully understand what is going on, you know, or how it was supposed to do it. So, you know, we see all these things and we hear these things that maybe he could be according to modern teaching. But we also know that Obama fits all of the, he stands outside of all of those things too. We know the Antichrist is going to take over and do this spectacular job, and then he's really going to become this hardline person for 42 weeks. And we know this too. You know, you and I were talking about this yesterday a little bit about the Gentiles in the book of the Revelation. For 42 months, they will be ruling, that the city itself will be trampled under the foot of them for this time, and that's during the time of the tribulation period. So there must be Gentiles there during that time ruling Jerusalem and the Temple Mount. We know that they're not talking about these Muslim people, because they're half Jewish. You know, they're the seed of Abraham. So that's another thing. You know, maybe it isn't from the tribe of Dan, but even if it isn't, we still see Obama fits all of those things. He's done all those things. The scripture tells us in Daniel 7:25, he will speak out against the Most High. And we know Obama's already made sly remarks against Jesus Christ. There are videotapes of him mocking Christ. He is speaking out against the Most High.
Yeah.
And then in Isaiah 5:20, it says, woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness, and put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. You know, that is the thing that's going on right now in this country. Every single thing that used to be goodness that America stood for during the 40s, 50s, and 60s is now being turned upside down, and it's being said it's wrong. And the real issue, Minister Paul, that what I see is the children. You know, these innocent children in school, and that through the education system, they seek to turn these kids from little boys into little girls and little girls into little boys, or some kind of binary or trinary thing that they're calling them, or whatever it is. And it's an obscenity in God's eyes. And how can any nation do all of these things that we have done in the last few years? For instance, you know, abortion, and then as soon as the abortion law is overthrown, you know, this Roe v. Wade thing, which really was allowing them to kill, take a life, and it gets overthrown. What do? They start bombing, attacking Christian churches, and they start attacking people on the streets, and all this hate, because you're trying to save a life. You know, you're trying to save somebody from pain, and they're attacking them. So this country really has fallen so far from where we were in the beginning of our walk as basically a Christian nation, you know.
They're coming.
Better
step away for a second.
So really, we've got so much evidence that point to this man, and especially with this latest news that you came out with about him. He's become this envoy to Kenya, which will put him in a position that he's very close to Israel. Say there is a nuclear war, Kenya probably won't be hit. You know, and
I'm going to bring up a map and show Kenya and how close it is to Israel while you talk.
Yeah, and so they, you know, they, that's the thing. He'll have ready access to that area. And since he's, as an envoy there, he has authority and power. He has place. They've even said in that article that they saw government vehicles there and CIA agents and stuff. So this is pretty much going to happen no matter what. You know, this is a plan, and it's part of this whole thing. You know, there's just enough doubt allowed so that somebody can't take this and use it like a treasure map and find their way to heaven. You know, like Jesus said, before the kingdom of God was taken by the violent. Now it's about this love thing, and you have to have the Holy Spirit in you to have discernment, to know what God is doing. And then, you know, you can do all these things in Christ, you know, through the Holy Spirit. And before, people could just read a rule book. You know, okay, I got to keep these 613 laws and I'm good. It wasn't about what was in their hearts. And that's why, you know, the Lord had said so many times, you know, give us examples about people's hearts. If you look upon a woman with lust, you've done it. If you hate your brother, you've committed murder. If you, he talks about the man, the priest coming out, wearing all of his priestly gear, and he says, "Thank you, O Lord God, that I am not like that guy over there." And he points to this guy that's of low esteem, and the guy is so pitiful about his own personal self that he can't look up because he's so ashamed of who he is, and he's repenting to God and asking God to forgive him. And the priest is saying, "I'm glad I'm not like that guy."
Right.
It's the heart, you know. And really, I think the whole thing about what we're talking about right here with this, with Obama, current events, with the temple thing, all this stuff happening, them, they found the tablet that was written on Mount Ebal with Jacob and Caleb when they were getting ready to go into the promised land, and they did the blessing and cursings. They found the tablet of blessing and cursing there. They found it. And it's like 2,600 years, 2,800 years ago, this was written. And it's written, and then it's encased in lead, and the lead they've tested only comes from Egypt, from the lead mines in Egypt.
I was just showing Egypt on the map.
It's just mind-blowing. You know?
Tell me about, we talked yesterday, tell me about, we talked about the tribe of Dan, we talked about Obama going to Kenya. Then you talked about the American flag and how it's even based in Roman.
Yeah.
Right?
Right, the Roman, I spoke about that a little bit. I talked about how the Roman pole that they had a pole that they took into battle and had some flags on it, but the main part of it was this brass or gold colored eagle that was on top of it. And they had lost one for like several hundred, 300 years or so. And it took them that long to go back and recover this, but they sent a legion in there and took that back because it was that important of a symbol to Rome, this eagle being this bird of prey over everybody. And it was one of the largest birds of prey on the planet. And so that came to Britain and it came to America. We adopted the very same thing. It's the American eagle, the eagle being on most flagpoles. There'll be an eagle on top of that. There's an eagle represented all over American literature. So I really believe we are just a continuation of the old Roman Empire. And whether they meant it to be like that in the very beginning, it's the same thing with everything else in our country right now. It is morphed because of those that are controlling and pulling the strings, the people that are in power. They are taking this country and changing it from what it was to what it is now. You know, it's this something really that is turns the stomach of the Lord, you know. And so we as Christians, we need to spend time in prayer, praying for our loved ones and for salvation and for the children, revival to our hearts.
For the children.
Yeah, and for those children, especially because, you know, those schools have those kids for almost as much time as their parents do. You know, and they're putting these ideas into children's heads, and at those ages, they're very, very, very able to be influenced by an adult, especially somebody that respects, acts like they respect them, and they give them fun and games. They're not like mom and dad telling them what they have to do, or to clean their bedrooms, or to eat their vegetables, or whatever. These people are make themselves into friends of these children. And so we're only doing this for your good, and you can't tell mama and daddy. The same thing that a pedophile does, they are doing. You know, if this was happening 10, 15 years ago, those teachers that are pushing this agenda would be called pedophiles, and they would be put in prison for the very thing that they're doing. They're talking to kids about sex at a very young age. You know, we're not talking about kids that are in high school.
In their books, in the books they read and everything.
Right, right. You know, and it's just insidious what is going on, so.
And we know what Jesus said about the children and being like children and, you know, the millstone around the neck type thing. It just, how, Gary and I were talking about how restrained and patient is God to see this happening to children. They're literally operating on them like at 8 years old to transition them. And they blocked it to where you can't offer therapy to not transition anymore. You're not allowed. You can just, brother, for real, how can everybody not see that? It's so clear. How can everybody not see we are heading down the road to destruction?
Oh, yeah.
In America, like you said, we've both seen it nuked.
Yes.
How can everybody, well, people are seeing it. And it's videos like this that are going to wake people up too. Someone's going to stumble across this video and they're going to learn all this stuff. And they probably had no idea.
Exactly.
And it'll wake them up. That's why we're doing this today, is to for more people can get out there and know the truth, because the truth set you free.
Yeah, exactly. You know, with information, you can change the world. And if you can't change the whole world, maybe, but you can change around you, and you can influence the people that you have day-to-day contact with. You can influence your loved ones. You can, you know, you can make a difference. And, you know, if you're aware, we know that the scripture tells us that prayer changes things, that God hears us when we pray.
Yes.
He absolutely does. And so if we are, like you're saying, in your prayer closet, you know, a lot of times the devil and our own mind will trick us into believing that we are having a prayer life because we're saying a prayer as we're driving to work, or we're saying a prayer, you know, at this time or that time, and we're really not, you know, dedicating our lives. Or maybe we're doing it at church on Sunday or morning or Sunday evening. And so, you know, there's no real dedication where you go into your prayer closet and you lock yourself away with the Lord and you really, you know, plead with him and talk with him about what's on your heart and what you're trying to do. So that's what I see. I see, you know, we get tricked into believing we're doing something, you know. Well, while I was brushing my teeth as I was getting ready for work, I said a quick prayer. Well, that's good, but you need to really have that dedicated time alone with the Lord in worship of God and doing those things that are, you know, like if you wanted to be someone that was really good at table tennis or at pool or at archery, well, you'd spend hours. You know, there's a guy that may spend 10 hours a week at archery, but the guy that spends 20 hours is going to be better. So we have to spend that time in the presence of the Lord.
Now more than ever.
Yeah. You've got to, you know, read his word and then go into prayer and really seek his face and really cry out, you know, feel that pain of these people. And these, especially these, like you said, these little kids, you know, that have no, they have no agency. You know, all they know is what mom and dad tells me or the teacher tells me, you know, and I really love my teacher and she's so kind. And, you know, and then these people are dressing up and being all strange. And it's interesting because they've got bright purple hair or pink hair or whatever. And these kids really think these teachers are something else. And so they love their teachers and they respect them.
And they're raised to be that way. It's like policemen. Yeah. Teachers are like policemen. You know, these are the good guys. You can trust them. Listen to what they say.
Yep. Exactly.
Hey, brother, and speaking of moms and dads, I just found I got my mom's old Bible, and you can see the highlighted. Let me see.
It's disappearing.
Yeah, it's doing funny things. There it is. See the.
Yeah.
Somehow it knows where I'm at. That's another thing. It knows exactly where I'm at, but where I'm not. It's just three scriptures. It's Psalm 107. It says, yet he sets the poor on high, far from affliction, and makes their families like a flock. The righteous see it and rejoice, and all iniquity stops its mouth. Whoever is wise will observe these things, and they will understand the loving kindness of the Lord. So in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us.
Yes, amen.
We're more than conquerors.
More, yeah. That's absolutely it's
heavy stuff. Heavy stuff we're talking about. I'd like to do this more often.
Yep, we need to.
The format. Fellowship room, is this format something that this is our first time? We get better and better as we do it and come together and pray. Is this something that you'd be interested in seeing this done? Let me know. Put one if you enjoy this format. Put one in the fellowship room. So that there's a delay, so that'll take a minute.
Yeah.
I've said everything I need to say for today.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, I think we're good.
We could go ahead and wrap it up, but do you want to pray for everybody in the room?
Yeah, we'll do a closing prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, my brothers and sisters and Minister Paul. He's a very dedicated man, God. We want you to send a special blessing his way for him and for his wife, God, for his ministry, that you put your hands upon him, God, and touch him with the power of the Holy Spirit. And Father, we ask that if there are any that are watching this show that are unsaved, that they would come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And we ask that you, if there are any that are sick and need healing, that the Holy Spirit would touch them and that would heal their body completely, God. If there are any that are depressed, Father God, we ask that your Holy Spirit be with them, that they know, that they would know in their hearts that you love them and that you are the only reason for living. It doesn't matter what happens to you in your life. It's really our relationship with you, because the world that we live in today is not the real world. It's the world that is coming after Christ returns. There's going to be such a beautiful place where nothing has to die anymore. And we're going to live at peace with you, and we're going to be able to look upon your beautiful face, Lord, every day. We can see you and we can commune with you. And we are so thankful that you made yourself apparent to us so that we could see you and we could know that you live and that you exist. And we thank you, Lord, for what you did on the cross for us almost 2,000 years ago, just 7 more years, Lord, and it'll be a full 2,000 years since you passed on the cross. So, Lord Jesus, we love you and we thank you, Lord. We thank you for your faithfulness, that you're with us every day, that the power of your Holy Spirit is upon us. We thank you, Lord, and we bless your name. We ask you that you'd undertake for our brothers and sisters in Israel, God, that you protect the 144,000 that are to come, and that you move upon those two men that are going to be the two witnesses, God. We ask that you'd undertake for the nations, God, for the women and the children that are in Ukraine that are suffering, God, and the husbands that have lost out. God Almighty, we ask your blessing upon them. Father, we ask that you'd undertake for this planet, God. We know that you love this world. Your word tells us, for God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe could be saved. So God, we ask you to undertake for all of your creation, Father God, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray and ask it. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. And Father God, I lift up Brother Gary and his household and the members of his household and his animals and his land, Lord, and I ask that you would bless him and keep him and protect him. I pray for everybody within the sound of my voice. Like Brother Gary said, if you're unsaved, message me, email me, get with someone in the fellowship room. Do not leave this talk unsaved. It's almost suicidal at this point when so many things are broken down and explained, and yet you would still want to walk away. Lord, we pray that you would draw. We would begin to feel a drawing of you, would draw all men to you, and let us learn to speak things that are not as if they are so, so we could be more like you. Let the weak say, I'm strong. Lord Jesus, I'm the healed and not the sick. I'm above and not below. I've never seen the righteous forsaken or the seed begging for bread. Lord, you're going to bless us. I'm listening to Job, Lord, and he just remained in his integrity and his faith. And we know in Hebrews 11, they all remained in their faith and they went through trials and they went through tribulations. And Jesus told us, in this world you'll have tribulations, but be of good cheer, for I've overcome the world. He overcame for us, and we celebrate him this day in Jesus' precious, mighty, holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Brother Gary.
You're welcome.
And I'll talk to you later. And everybody in the fellowship room, thank you so much for coming. If you haven't hit the like button yet, hit like on the way out. Get these algorithms going, and let's get this message spread out there. And even if one soul comes in, it says all of heaven rejoices. So let's pray for one soul and let God bring the increase. God bless you, brother.
God bless you.